We will continue again our study on getting up and getting down nowadays. This is number 12. We all know that sometimes we are up and sometimes we are down. Are you like that? Some say no. Some say yes. The title originates from the very thought that we are like roller coasters in our life. We are up the hill and down the hill. We also know in this up and down life that there is an invisible enemy. How many of you know that? There is an invisible battle going on. So we have in this traumatic, so to speak, up and down cycle of our lives, a very real battle. It's invisible, and we have an invisible enemy. We should remember the story of Elisha and his servant Gehazi. Gehazi saw the Syrians surrounding the city of Dothan in great numbers in horses and chariots. But Elisha prayed that Gehazi's eyes would be opened so that he could see the host of the Lord. The Lord answered Elisha's prayer, and the eyes of Gehazi were opened so he could see the host of the Lord all around them. The mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire. Now, I want you to think about that. Here's Gehazi, one minute, sees nothing but a whole host of Syrians. The next minute, after Elisha prays for him, he sees the mountains full of the host of the Lord and chariots of fire. You know what that could have been? That could have been the first UFO sighting in Israel. Chariots of fire. Well, I don't know if you know about this or not, but there's a song called Chariots of Fire. Have you ever heard it? Anyway, there's a song called Chariots of Fire, and I like it, and I think there's a movie that it goes with. Whatever the name, it might be the same name. But anyway, one day when I was out of work for a couple of years between jobs, I kidded with the children. I said, "We are going to start a trash pickup service with my old pickup. And I'm going to let you all hang off the back of the truck. And I'm going to put a big speaker in the grill, and it's going to play Chariots of Fire." I said, "And then I'm going to put a title on the side of the truck, Chariots of Trash." Well, they didn't laugh, and you didn't either. They didn't think it was funny. They didn't want to get on no truck and hang off the back of it like a trash man. But here is the point. We need to see what Gehazi saw. I wish the Lord would open our eyes so that we could see those chariots of fire right now. How many of you think that exists? It exists. So here's what Elisha prayed. I just want to give you the prayer of Elisha. He prayed, "Fear not," or he said to his servant after he prayed, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." Now, I don't know about you, but I would like to reemphasize that point tonight. Seriously, I would like to say to every one of us, we don't seem like a large group, but I want you to know something. There are more for us than there are for them. Amen? So you say the left has half the country, or the wicked and the immoral and the liberals have half the country and more than that in the world. But I want you to know this. Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. So in this invisible battle and invisible war with an invisible enemy, there are more with God's people than there are with the devil's people. Would somebody say amen? Aren't you glad that beyond this veil that we see, there is a tremendous host of God's people, of God's helpers? If there is an invisible, formidable enemy of the devil and his demons, then there is most assuredly a greater and more powerful force of heavenly angelic host of the Lord ready to do battle at a moment's notice. We must believe by faith and see the host of the Lord and pray that our captain would engage those hosts against the enemy for his cause. Now, I want you to know something, and I'm serious about what I'm saying right now. I am not what I ought to be, but I do pray for each and every one of us and for myself. And I think my biggest problem is in the mirror. How many of you know what I'm talking about? But I do pray for you, but I pray sometimes just like this. Not all the time, but sometimes I pray just like this. Lord, send your angelic fighting host to fight against any enemy that may come against, and then I'll put a name there. It might be your name. And let's just say that I have a bad attitude. You say, preacher, you don't get a bad attitude. Well, just don't ask me that. I do. But let's just say, I say, Lord, you're going to have to send your angelic host to fight against that bad attitude demon. How many of you know there's a bad attitude demon out there? And that bad attitude demon is trying to get every single one of us all twisted and all turned around and all upset. And I'm saying, Lord, send your host. I don't care if you have to send Michael the archangel, but send somebody to fight against my bad attitude demon. How many of you think that's probably a pretty good prayer? I think so. If there is an invisible enemy and there is an invisible host of the Lord fighting for us, then we need to pray that God would send his host to fight on our behalf for whatever our demons are and to fight for other people for whatever their demons are. You say, well, preacher, I tell you what, do you know, how many of you know we have blind spots? How many of you know that? In other words, you can see something about me that I don't see. That's called a blind spot. I can see something about you that you don't see. That's your blind spot. And you say, well, that person has a real problem with, and you name it. Say, I wish they could see it, but they can't see it. But we can pray this. Lord, open their eyes so that they can see the host of the Lord and send your host to fight against that, whatever that weakness is. Amen? Amen? Send your host to fight against that thought. So we have done some things in prayer that I think are necessary. But I want you to know something. We are not probably going to be defeated by the world and the flesh and the devil. That's a pretty big foe, pretty good trio, the devil's trinity, you might call it, the world, the flesh, and the devil. But that's probably not where we're going to get defeated. We're probably going to get defeated in the inner man. There's that invisible inside of you. It's where the battle is raging. In other words, we have learned on the outside to separate from the enemy or to separate from the wicked. So we live separate lives from those that we consider wicked people. We try not to do the things that wicked people do. We try not to even go to places that wicked people go. We try our best to separate physically ourselves from the world. So we have got separation down fairly well. By the way, in the last 10, 15 years, separation has been passe. In other words, out of the picture. We don't even want to think about it anymore. But still, I think even though it's not like it used to be, we're not as separated as we used to be, Christian people still, per se, like to separate from wickedness physically. But that's not where the battle really rages. The battle is not physically. We've learned to do some things physically. But the battle is in the inner man. The inner man cannot separate from the world, the flesh and the devil, and nobody knows it. And so the inner man thinks, I can get away with this. Nobody knows it. I would remind you that God does know it. Is that right? So even though in that inner man's secret, invisible world, we may not be separate at all from evil, I want you to know something. If we are not separate from evil in the inner man, then this outer man business of separation is really of no use whatsoever. You know what Jesus called the Pharisees when they said, we do this and we do this, and they name all these things. We tithe mint and cumin and all this stuff. And Jesus says, on the outside, you look pretty good. You're whited sepulchers. The old preacher said sepulchres. I don't know what a sepulchre is, but sepulchres. So he said, you're whited sepulchres. But inside, you're full of dead men's bones. In other words, like a rotten corpse in a cave or in a tomb. I wonder, this is what I wonder, how many of us have, so to speak, won the battle of the outward man physically and separated from the world, the flesh, and the devil outwardly. But I wonder how many of us have really separated from the world, flesh, and the devil in the inner man. You see, that is where the battle rages. That's the invisible war I'm talking about. So we think we've got this war over here won and fought and we're doing it. But we're not really fighting the inner battle at all. The Bible says in Ephesians 6:12 in our passage of scripture that we've been using for this subject, it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Plain out tells you, this is chapter 6, verse 12 of Ephesians, it plain out tells you the battle is not physical. The battle is different than physical. But against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That is an inner battle against darkness. The believer wrestles with rulers of the darkness of this world. It says, for we wrestle not against some things, flesh and blood, but we do wrestle against, and then it names those things. And one of them is the rulers of the darkness of this world. We have been called out of darkness. I don't know if you understand that, and I don't know if I understand it totally. I know I've been saved out of darkness, and you know you've been saved out of darkness, the darkness of sin. But we have been called out of darkness. 1 Peter 2:9. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You and I have been called out of darkness. And when the Bible says to remember your calling and election and to keep it, boy, we ought to remember this calling that we ought to keep is being called out of darkness. We ought to remember that one. So we have not only been called out of darkness into his marvelous light, but we have been delivered or saved or even continually being saved out of darkness, and not only continually being saved out of darkness, but translated into the kingdom of his dear Son. Here's what it says in Colossians 1:13, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Another powerful scripture about how we are not in darkness. So the believer must not hobnob with darkness because he's been called out of it, he's been delivered from it, he's been saved from it, he's been translated into the kingdom of dear Son and been called into his marvelous light. So since we are called into his marvelous light, translated into the kingdom, then we don't need to fraternize, hobnob, fellowship with darkness. Amen. The Bible says this. 1 John 1:5, this then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. In other words, that is a believer's passage. That's not to unbelievers. A person can say, I'm walking in the truth or walking in the light, when in reality they are not walking in the light, they're walking in darkness. He said, don't say you're fellowshipping with God. You can't fellowship with God because God is light and in him is no darkness at all. And if you walk in darkness, you cannot fellowship with God. It's that truth. These truths should be, as the Constitution or preamble, whatever says, are self-evident, should be, the truth that darkness and light do not mix when it comes to the spiritual growth of a believer. And this spiritual growth of the believer is of utmost importance in this invisible war. God is light, and the believer is indwelt by the Spirit of God and cannot fellowship with God while walking or living is what we would think. I mean, walking, we think physical walking, but that's living everyday life, living an everyday life in habitual darkness. When we live every day like the world, that may not be in our physical body, but in our mind or in our spirit or in our inner man, then we are walking in or living in darkness. Now, I want to know that I don't want to do that. How many of you would say with me, I don't want to live in darkness? Is that right? Don't want to. I don't want to. But sometimes we do. That's why I'm saying getting up and getting down. Many times when we are down, we are walking in darkness. And I'll tell you something else. Many times when we get up spiritually, the next thing is down spiritually. That's strange. We get up spiritually and say, man, I've got it. And then the next thing you know, boom, walking in darkness. May the Lord help us. Amen. We need his host to fight for us. So here's what I think. I want to give you an astounding assessment of what I have just explained. I believe the greatest hindrance, I do not know all the numbers, and I don't know all the formulas, and I don't know everything, of course, about revival. I don't know everything about you, and you don't know everything about me. So there's a lot we don't know. We have limited knowledge. But I do know this, I believe, that the greatest hindrance to our life and spiritual growth is walking in darkness at certain times. Sometimes we may walk in darkness more than we walk in the light. Folks, we need to think, if there is going to be power of God, revival in our heart, revival in our heart. I'm not talking about revival. Listen, let's forget about hollering about revival for the world. Let's forget about hollering about revival for the state. Let's forget about hollering about revival around here. Let's forget about hollering about revival in the church, even though I wish we would have a real God-sent revival in the church. But let's think about this. What about revival in our heart? Amen. What about that? You say, preacher, what is it? When we walk in darkness and do not the truth, we're lying. We're not walking in fellowship with God. So I believe the great hindrance to your spiritual growth, to your spiritual revival, to your spiritual power, to your spiritual boldness in witnessing. I was listening to Gail read that letter just now, and guess what? Brother Sanchez had boldness to talk to the priest the way he talked to him. I mean, that was flat out putting it to him. And I doubt if many of us could say the words that he said to a Catholic. But that was good. What he said was on the money. Amen? It was right on the money. So I wonder if there is no spiritual power in witnessing, no boldness in witnessing, no spiritual revival in our hearts because inwardly we walk in darkness and nobody knows it but us and God. 1 Thessalonians 5:4 says, but ye brethren are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. In other words, they were talking about the second coming of the Lord. And he said, if you are in the light, talking about the people that were afraid that Jesus had already come in 1 Thessalonians, and if the rapture had already taken place or if Jesus had already come, what would happen to their loved ones? They were so concerned. And Paul says, wait just a minute, you're not in darkness. That day is not going to overtake you like a thief. You will know you are a believer walking in the light, and you will know when Jesus comes. In other words, here's the other side of that coin. Here's one side of it. One side of it is if you are walking in the light, you know what God's doing and you know what God's will is. The other side of that coin is if you're walking in darkness, you don't know what God's doing. Two sides of that coin. The rulers of darkness are at work in each person's heart or inner man. I was impressed by Tim's discussion of two hearts this morning. That is exactly what we're referring to tonight. The rulers of darkness are at work in each person's heart or inner man. And I will say, beware of the darkness, because it is detrimental to your fellowship with God, and it is detrimental to your fellowship with other believers. It is deadly, most of all. Walking in darkness is deadly to our souls, for it blinds our spiritual understanding. I don't know about you, but I need all the spiritual understanding I can get to know what God wants us to do from God's Word. Amen. I need that, and you need it too. In our 16 D's of the devil, we have studied 9 of them. Disappointment, discouragement, despair, doubt, disbelief, distraction, double-mindedness, dishonesty, and deceit. We are going to pick up another one for a few minutes tonight, another D. And I'm going back to our analogy of the captain coming into the war room with his special operations squad. And the squad is there. They've already come into the room. The room is tense because the captain is expected momentarily. And these are well trained. I mean, at the peak of every part of condition that you can imagine. Mentally, physically, everything. They're at their peak. Fine young men, a squad of special operations soldiers. And in just a moment, the captain is going to come into the room and discuss with them the formidable enemy that they face. And this will be the 10th time that they have met together. And they have already experienced some things of the first 9. And they have talked about those things and how they had to fight some battles with those 9 other things of the enemy or tactics of the enemy. So what could the captain talk about tonight? What is the captain going to say? What is his 10th D of the devil? The captain comes into the room, and immediately all the men stand to their feet with a curt salute and stand at attention until the captain of the host of the Lord, none other than the Lord Jesus Christ, says, at ease, men. And they quietly take their seats. And he says to them, tonight we are going to discuss the 10th tactic of the devil. And as we have said before, there is an invisible hand with only a finger showing that begins to write on the blackboard behind the captain. And it writes this: D, U, L, L, N, E, S, S. Now we know what our scriptures say in Ephesians chapter 6 and how we are to take the armor of the Lord. I'm not going to read that passage again, but that is the background. I've read verse 12 tonight, but that is the background for the captain's discussion. So the captain says, after, I'm sure, referring to Ephesians chapter 6 and the Christian soldier, the sword of the Spirit, helmet of salvation, shoes of the gospel, breastplate of righteousness, it's a girdle of truth. I'm sure he discusses that briefly. And then says, tonight, men, I want you to know something. Dullness is one of the greatest tactics of Satan. You and I, talking about the soldiers and the captain, we must keep our minds sharp and our physical strength strong. We must keep our weapons oiled and ready. We must sharpen the edges of steel. Everything we do depends on being ready physically and spiritually. There is great danger in having our minds dull. There is great danger in having our physical condition soft by leisure. We must stay fit and not soft. We must stay strong and not weak. I was thinking earlier about that old song, I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. Boy, I'll tell you what, we need that kind of thought. Our weapons, the captain says, must be readily accessible and highly effective. A defective weapon means life or death. Weapons must be maintained always. Swords must be sharpened. This is a life or death struggle. A dull sword will not help in the intense fight. Dullness of mind, dullness of weapons, and dullness or softness of body will not be successful in this great war. So he says, the first thing I want you to know is to keep your minds sharp. 1 Peter 3:15 is the passage of scripture that the captain is going to use now, and he's going to refer to Peter as a lieutenant. And he says, our lieutenant Peter, from the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God, said these words to each of us as soldiers: but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. The Christian soldier is to keep his mind sharp so that he can always be ready to speak up for the captain. Now I want you to think about that. He keeps his mind sharp so that he can speak up for the captain. It says, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. And that sanctify means to set him apart. That means to make him first in your heart. That means that every soldier must keep the captain and his words in his heart all the time, and keep him in their heart as number one. Christ as the captain should be the focus of every soldier if he is to speak for Jesus Christ. There is a spot in everyone's heart each of you has a spot in your heart that is just for whatever is first place. Some people call it a throne. I don't know what you call it. All I know is this: every person has a spot in their heart for whatever is first place in their life and in their heart. We do know that the Bible says, God said it to the children of Israel, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." That's Exodus 20 and verse 3. "Thou shalt not make unto thee," verse 4, "any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth." Graven images has a broad meaning. We don't have statues, even though the Catholic Church has statues. We don't have statues in this church. We don't have them out there in the lawn. We don't have them in our flower garden. I don't have a saint statue beside my house or beside my door. So I don't have a graven image like that. But there are other images. There are images of light. And images of light, the Bible says that Satan is like an angel of light. And we have images of light in our living room. It's called a television. Those are images. Just as much as those little statues, the image on the TV is just as much an image as this little statues. You say, "Well, I would never go to Rome and kiss St. Peter's toe," so to speak. No, but we have images. "I would never be like the Japanese and have a little shrine." Well, I want to ask you something. Most entertainment centers look just like a shrine, don't they? Yes, they look just like a shrine. A Christian lady says, by the way, it says in Exodus 20 and verse 5, "Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me." He said, "I'm a jealous God. I don't want you worshiping any other image, whether it be out of wood, whether it be out of stone, or whether it be out of light." A Christian lady said this: "It's not God first and then we get on with the rest of our lives. Rather, God is all in all. He is in everything and in every way a part of our daily living. We live every day with an awareness of the presence and power of God." And she quotes a verse: "For in Him we live and move and have our being." Acts 17, 28. Now, everything about us is God. Our Lord is worthy of our attention in everything we do, in everything we say, and in everything we think. As believers, we have the Holy Spirit within prompting us toward righteousness in our attitudes and behavior. As we move in the Spirit, we can't help but put God first in everything. 1 Corinthians 10:31. "Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God." Hudson Taylor, in recruiting missionaries for China, said this: "Christ is either Lord of all, or He is not Lord at all." Here's what Hudson Taylor was saying: "I do not want recruits for China to be without this one primary characteristic: Christ is Lord of all." He said, if that's not true of a recruit for China, then I don't want them to go to China. You know what Hudson Taylor's saying? "I know the battle is fierce against the wickedness and the idolatry in China. It's an invisible war. It's an invisible battle. And I know it's a fierce battle over there for the souls of man. And I cannot have a young person going to war in China if Christ is not first in their heart." If the devil can keep you and I from putting Christ first, then he has got us dull. And that's exactly what he wants. He wants Christ to be dethroned in our hearts, mine and yours. He wants Christ to be dethroned so that we will be dull. That's his tactic. The believer cannot allow the competitors to fill that permanent or preeminent first spot of the heart. Those competitors are given in the parable of the sower these titles: hard, that hard soil, or hardness of heart, or we could say dullness. So the word of God fell on ground. Some of it was hard. And when Christ is not on the throne of our heart, the word of God falls on hard ground because we are dull. Christ is not first. And then it says that shallowness, there was not depth to the soil. So there's a shallow Christian living today. I'm not saying that we're the ones guilty, and I can't point at another group and say they are shallow. I'm just saying the devil wants each of us to live shallow Christian life, not really meaning it, just going through the motions. How many of you know that going through the motions is just absolutely death to the spiritual growth? Going through the motions is absolutely death to spiritual growth. If that's all we're doing is going through the motions, then we need to rethink what we're doing. Amen? Amen. So there's the competitors of dullness or hard heart or shallowness, and then there's the competitor of cares of this world, and that seems to creep in more than we want to think. And then deceitfulness of riches is another. Those are the four things that take first place in our heart. And one of those, deceitfulness of riches, I think is one of the greatest. But all four of them, every one of them, are competitors for the first place in our heart. I recently spoke to a man, and this is a real life situation. I recently spoke to a man, and I was just in conversation with him. Not witnessing to him. He was a professed Christian. But I noticed as I began to talk to him that he could tell me every movie star from 1950 to now, almost every one of them, especially those in the past, some of the older movie stars, and he could tell me every movie that they were in, and he could tell me what every movie was about. He had the storyline for every movie, and he knew the life history of every star, male and female, and he could tell me every one of them. And I'm thinking, my goodness, this guy is a walking encyclopedia on movie stars and their life and their movies. But then I also realized when it came to talking about the Bible, that was just not a very popular subject. That was just not something to talk about. I want you to know something, folks. If we know more about the world than we know about Jesus Christ, something's bad wrong. Is that right? And I know people don't like some of that, but that's the truth. Ephesians 6:17, one of our scriptures says, "And take the helmet of salvation." The helmet of salvation. That means keep your mind sharp, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So the first one is from our captain is keep your mind sharp. I've got two more, but I'm not going to do them tonight. You'll have to wait till next time. Let's pray.